All right, hopefully that's not too glossy. This is the Great Battles of Alexander, the Macedonian Art of War, which is the fifth edition of the first in the Great Battles of History series, the Deluxe fifth edition in this case. The newest one that's available as of 2017. It comes with a number of things. 19 battles. From 358 to 207 BC. It's interesting in that not only does it cover all of Alexander's major battles, but it covers his father's, Philip's II's, as well. And that's actually who we're going to start with here. A battle of Philip II. So I think you can see the entire map and all the counters for the battle. This side is Philip, the Macedonians. This side, I want to say, is the Illyrians. But let's check that. This is Erigon Valley, Upper Macedonia, 358 BC. Yeah, it's the Illyrians. I could read the whole thing here, but I don't know how interesting that is, the sort of background of the battle itself. But basically, Philip has created a new type of phalanx that uses longer spears called sarisses, S-A-R-I-S-S-A-S, with lighter armor, but you know they have the much longer pole arms. So a bit of pooching in the map here. I didn't want to put it under anything for more glare. But the Illyrians had beaten the Macedonians before, so for this particular scenario, they have a special rule that subtract 2 from all Illyrian pre-shock TQ check rolls unless the Illyrians are being attacked by a Hadassapist or a companion cavalry. This remains in effect until a Illyrian hoplite unit routs or Bartolus is killed or wounded, their leader here. So this is my first time playing any of the Great Battles of History series. I've played Men of Iron before, which seems like a simpler version. There seems to be a lot of similarities, a few differences in the way that routes are handled, or routing units. They don't just teleport back to their standards, but they actually run off the map, which would be a bit more complicated. Cav seems a bit more complicated in this, and the fact that it can have formations, and the biggest thing is the tactical quality, or this idea of tactical quality. So if you see the numbers, the white numbers in the gray boxes here, and the Macedonians are quite high compared to other armies for the most part, that's their tactical quality. So whenever they want to do something that has a chance of breaking morale, such as engaging the enemy, you have to roll against that. And if you roll over it, then you start to take some cohesion hits. And if you are attacked successfully, and so on and so forth, you'll start taking cohesion hits. Once those get above your number, I think it's equal or above, I'll have to check, you start routing away. Like Men of Iron, you can't see it, but there's a route point board up just beyond the map there. Once in this particular battle, either side hits 40 route points or more, the army withdraws, and then the other army wins. There's no die roll in this one, like there is in Men of Iron, where you start rolling a d10 and add it to your route points, and this one is just once you hit that set number. A few notes here. So the map, we are using a half map here, but we're ignoring all terrain. So it's as if it was just completely flat. Compass rose, you can see up there which way is north. This one is using counters for the Philip II modules, which are all included in the box itself, as well as from the Diadochi module, which is also included in the box itself. It has the Diadochi module, the Phalanx module, and the Raphia module included in the battles that were originally in the deluxe version of Alexander the Great, as well as some Philip II stuff, which I think came from C3i magazine. I also have, generously, I can't remember his name, I should have written it down, but a BGG user very generously gave me the Battle of Hellespont, 321 BC, that came from the most recent C3i magazine. So I'm going to be playing through these in chronological order, so we'll hit that one at some point. We have a couple of very nice glossy, double-sided color player aids, which we will be needing. The rule book is, this is, I would say, the most complicated game that I've attempted thus far, although I am glad I have tried Men of Iron first, because there are a lot of similarities. It's 40, well, not including the sources, we've got 41 pages of rules, non-glossy color rule book. It was a joy to read through. I really like Richard Berg's rules. Not everyone is as much as a fan, but I find them the easiest to understand and the most enjoyable to read of all the ones that I've done so far. So that was certainly no problem. And then we also have another 40 pages here of scenarios. Well, just in this book, the Diadochi module has its own scenarios, and so does the Raffi, and so on and so forth. Okay, but for this particular one, let's look at what we've got here. I like also how it mentions difficulty and balance as far as how hard the battle is, like, tactically or rules-wise, and how long it might take, and also the balance, because any battle involving Alexander, if it's going to be historical, probably isn't going to be very balanced, because he was undefeated and widely regarded as one of the greatest generals of all time. But it says that this battle is a straightforward infantry fight between relatively small armies balanced in number and quality. Philip has a slight edge due to the superiority of his phalanx units over most of the Illyrian troops. It's a good introduction to the system. Couple hours at most for the game length. The Macedonians are retreating towards the south, which is this way, and the Illyrians to the north. And I think that's it. Let's have a look at the forces. I'm still getting over a sickness, a cold of some sort, so I apologize for the voice. But let's look at what we have here. So we have some skirmishes over here, some slingers. We have light peltast on our left flank. That should not be flipped that way. That indicates that they've been moved the other side of the counter. Unlike Men of Iron, which is a disordered side, not the case here. Then we have our phalanx units, which are not quite as good as the ones we'll be getting under Alexander, but these are still better than the Illyrians. These are interesting in that they take up two hexes, so we can do wheeling maneuvers if we need to maneuver them, like turn them in one direction or another, although that takes cohesion hits for non-Macedonian units, basically. You know, this sort of replicates the fact that the Macedonian discipline really gave them an edge in terms of combat. So we are a lot more free in our maneuvers, and most of our leaders are much superior than the enemies. I think he's supposed to be one here. So then we have our phalanxes. We have our hadaspist, which are heavy infantry, but are supposed to be very, very fast, as far as, like, historical goes. You'll see they have a movement of 5 here, which is as fast as sort of the missile units, most of the missile units, anyway. So they're quite good units. We have our one division or unit of companion cavalry here, and then we have some more slingers. On the other side, again, skirmishers, these are medium infantry units, not missile units, which is what MI triggers to my brain when I look at it, but it's medium infantry. So they're going to have a tough time against the Hadaspist, but they do have more of them. But we have more sort of phalanx units. These aren't quite as good. These are hoplites. And then some more medium infantry with, again, flanks of some light infantry, some javelinists here. Okay, so I think we'll just go ahead and get started. We start initiative. Each leader has an initiative rating, and you start with the lowest. Let me figure out which number is the initiative one. It's the big one. So we have a 6, a 5, a 4, a 6, and a 4. So I think we get to choose which one we want to go. Well, we can, we have a command range in the lower left-hand corner of the leaders, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So he can command, you know, everyone out to here, and he can command 4 of those units. That includes the unit he's on. He has to give them a command unit as well if he were to move them. That number 2 there, Philip here has a 3, is their charisma, which is the bonus that they give in melee combat. And they also have a personal combat rating, which is the red circle here, if they were to get into fight with a leader against a leader. Other things of note, the number of stars is their rank. And I think that's it. Some of them, not in this battle, but in some of the larger battles, some commanders will have the capacity of doing a line command. So instead of activating a number of individual units up to their initiative number, instead they can just do a line of a certain type of unit. Not the case here, though. So, let's see. Which way do we want to go? I'm thinking that we want to get those cav possibly pinned down before they have an opportunity to charge. So we're going to get to move both of our flanks first, probably anyway. Although you can do a trump in this, where you try to roll, I believe it's under your initiative rating, and if you're able to, you skip everyone previous to that, basically. So, let's see. Probably should have examined this and thought about it a little more before I started filming. He has a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So he can only go to here. I'm wondering if that's actually the place he's supposed to be set up, because that seems like a poor place. Well, he's supposed to be in hex 3407. That is 3407. I might be missing some units. Yeah. I'm supposed to have a couple of light cav. Let's get those on the board. Okay. So we have some light cav. And he's here. All right, well, I say then let's have him activate, try and wheel these cav around to maybe drive away some of these skirmishers and light peltasts, maybe get around to the flank behind these Macedonian units, try to engage here, stop this companion cavalry from doing anything similar, and then we'll just move in to engage with our center units. So, yeah, let's try that. All right, now these are ranged units, and they can do something called I forget the exact term, but basically they can remain at a distance while pelting, a harassment dispersal. So light cav can do it at a range of 4 hexes. So what that means is we can get them up 1, 2, 3, 4, within 4. And the idea is, even though it's not reflected on their movement on the map, but what they're doing is they're running in, they're throwing javelins, and then they're running back to a safe distance, is kind of the general idea. So I think we're going to give that a shot. And I don't think we have to start I'm just reading here. It says, to use harassment dispersal, light cavalry must be within 4 hexes, and all other types must be within 2, but not adjacent to the target and not within an enemy zone of control. Must have line of sight. I just want to make sure we don't have to start our turn. And it doesn't appear to be the case. They have to have the same or lower movement allowance. Requires a move order. Is movement for the purposes... Okay, so it consumes the entire movement allowance. So we'll move up and we'll consider, we'll use the harassment dispersal on a later turn. So let's see in the chart here what our rolls are going to be like for missile range. Mounted javelin. Within one range, they need a 3 or less. And it counts as one range once they do that dispersal stuff. So I can move them in. 1, 2. They have a movement of 8. They can fire at any time within movement. And these guys cannot do shock attacks. I think we can come in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then we could pull back. Because you can do fire at any time during movement. I'd like to be able to pull back more than that, is the thing. So let's just get into better position and not start firing this turn, I think. Not rush things. So what we'll do is we'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like this. We'll bring him likewise over here. He has only 4 units that he can command. What about these javelinists? What are their range? Only a range of 1 as well. I think I'll actually bring them in a little closer. So that's 1, 2, 3. We can only do 4 units. And now, 4, 5, he's out of range. That's the problem. Well, let's leave him. He doesn't have to go with them. So I'm actually going to leave him here. 2, 3, 4. So he can command a greater array of individuals. All right, so that'll be that one. Done. This would be the next one. So we can't get everyone. I do not especially want to engage with our javelinists. These guys are medium infantry. Against Hadassapists, which are heavy infantry, is probably not the best chart. We're on the 6th chart, which is not fantastic. So melee combat is kind of complicated. There's a lot of steps to it. Let me see if I can read out the steps here. So basically, we're in our leader activation phase. The lowest initiative inactive leader activates. Oh, this guy needs to see if he can go again, trying to roll under his initiative. He doesn't, so he's finished. So now it would be this guy. So they get to issue their orders. We do issue orders, and then the shock segment. So you do shock designation, the charge, resolution of leader combat, clash of spears, resolve shock combat, check for possible breakthrough, check for possible collapse and rout. So there's a series of steps that we're going to have to do once we start getting into melee combat. We have to basically make sure that they're going to engage at all by checking against their tactical quality. And we're going to have to check against the different types of units to see what columns we're going to roll on, and as well as if someone has either attacker superior or defender superior, depending on the type of units. right, so we're not going to get to go again with him. So we will get to go here. I think it's good to just go ahead and engage them. It gives us more room to route, if nothing else, I suppose. And this is my first time here, so I'm not going to claim in any sense of the word a sound tactical strategy. Skirmisher javelin years. Surprised that their range is only a 1. Although I suppose that makes sense. Javelins are not the most ranged of units, but let's chuck them at the cav, I think. So it's going to be a bit of a problem because we're going to get within one of him. Well, it's a couple of problems. So this guy has a higher movement speed of him. So he can, once he gets within 2 spaces, he can fall back, do an orderly withdrawal. So he's probably not going to stick around for us to throw spears at him. I could move in here and chuck them at the Hadassapists. That seems risky as well. Let's see, we have a movement of 6. We could go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We could come around. Range units like this have threatening in their flanks and their frontages. So that's not particularly helpful at this point. Just not sure what to really do with him. Well, I suppose, okay, let's move up on the assumption that he's going to move back, and then that might give us the opportunity to then take some flank on the Hadaspis. All right, so that's the plan. Let's see if we can execute that plan. Let's see. We're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. This guy is going to get to fire. He is a slinger at ranged 1, so he needs a 3 or less. He does not get it. This guy actually, once he got within 2 spaces, would have to choose, and he will with draw so that he can come back around and try some flank actions. Let's see how much he actually has to withdraw. I believe it's 2 movement points, but we should check. Order withdrawal. Skirmishers may withdraw up to 2 hexes. That's an exception. Regardless of how many hexes they actually move phalanx, it's not helpful either. To do this, the friendly and active unit withdraws a number of movement points equal to the difference between the movement points. So a 6, a difference of an 8 is 2, so that would indeed be 1, 2. And so he was 1, 2, 3, 4, and he's actually going to stop there and hopefully leave the ability for him. Wow, that's going to be difficult, isn't it? So that was within 2. He had to make his choice, so we'll do it there instead. He fired. That didn't work. So now he is going to try and do a javelin. He rolled a 9, which is no good, and also marks him missile low, which means another high roll like that, and he will be out of javelins. He would have to get out of combat, basically, to get refilled. Okay, so that's that. So that was 1. Let's try 1, 2, 3, 4. We'll take the shot. Nope. No good. It's an 8. I'm not sure if 8 gets us a missile low on slingers or not. It's probably in the charts. Need to familiarize myself a little more with them. Here we go. Archers, slingers, and elephant screens on a 9. Javelinist on a 7, 8, or 9. Alright, and then he's going to move, because he doesn't have a zone of control, because he's a skirmisher, he can't melee attack. So, I can change facing while I move. So something like this. He can do a reaction to change his facing as well. Although I'm not too sure that I'm worried about it. I'm thinking that I'll just have the Cav attack him next turn. And keep him safe for more units coming this way. Because if I turn him, yeah, he seems to be in danger if I were to do that. So I am going to keep him facing in that direction. So this is a medium infantry. Maybe I should have kept the horseman there. I need to do some stuff first. We do all the movement before we do our shock stuff. So shock, must check TQ. This will be a 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's the same. That was 1, 2, 3. We only have 4 that we can do. Actually not sure that I want to engage anyone else. I might want to come over here instead. Let's do a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. He's going to get a shot. Nope. Okay. We don't have to do a TQ check. It's that. Fire. 7 is no good. And actually a 7 is a missile low. Him. All right. So, shock designation, the charge. All right, let's have a look here. So, we need to make sure that they're going to stick around. I'll roll against their tactical quality. I believe it's equal to or less than, but let's check. That's going to be under shock combat. All right, the charge. If a unit is attacked by both types, okay. Any unit attacking a skirmisher doesn't need to do one. If they're attacking a routed unit, they don't need to do one. Phalanxes and heavy infantry that are attacked frontally by light infantry do not have to do it. Chariots don't have to do it, and this guy will have to do it as well. Although he can't shock. I don't know if we mark him or not, but he still has to roll. And this guy, I think, is going to be in combat as well. Alright, if the defending unit, if the die roll is higher than the unit's TQ check, the unit incurs a number of cohesion hits equal to the difference between the die roll and its TQ. Alright, so do we do this simultaneously or one after another? If the attack and defending units involved in the same combat would route from their TQ checks, use the procedure in 10-15 to determine which unit routes. Alright, so I think we just roll it. So we'll start for him. He needs a low number, 0, so he's good. So he's checked. This guy needs to check. He only has a 3. In fact, though, he's a skirmisher. When they came within 2 of him, he could have moved back. But then he wouldn't have got to fire his shots, so I'll call that as okay. So he's broken. So he's routed. We'll get back to him in a little bit. This guy got a 5. He has an 8, so he takes 3 cohesion hits. And I think I'm doing this right. Okay, he's fine. All right, so next we do the Clash of Spears. So let's see what's happening. Let's do... now do... In Men of Honor, you have to attack everyone within your frontal hexes. Is that the case here? Alright, and we're back. Some poor rolls for the Macedonians so far. I haven't done the routes yet. I suppose I should have done that before I came back. But we took worse, except for here. As far as the cohesion hits goes, we're going to have some checks here. I suppose I'll show it on the fact that the phalanxes get bonuses on that check. So that's interesting. We'll have a look at that. Otherwise, the only other one that might go is this guy. So let's roll him. Yep, he's going to turn tail. So he would immediately flip and go 1, 2. And he's going to be routed. Now, I think we can swing in there, but let's take care of this first. All right, so we roll like normal, I think. Or he might get a roll before that. I need to check. Basically, phalanxes get an extra ability to possibly stay around. I'm not sure if that's under special units. Here we go. Inane Shock, phalanx defense. Inane Shock resolution. Which unit moves adjacent to and shock attacks a phalanx frontally, the shock column is adjusted. Well, that doesn't help. That doesn't help either. They can also go into square, but none of that is what I want to know. Instead, what I want to know is they get an extra check. I know they do. Looking in effects of combat. I don't see it here. That could be in the rout phase. We apply the results. We're doing the push. There we go. Exception. If a 2-hex phalanx slash heavy infantry unit would rout, the owning player uses the exception procedure in 9-13 to determine whether the unit routes or stands. However, if the unit is a defender and the attacker has position supporting, there is no die roll. All right, so 9-13 is what we need to check. 9-13, that's back, actually. Wait, 9-13? Wait, that doesn't make any sense. Oh, here we go. If a 2-hex phalanx slash heavy infantry unit would rout, the owning player first rolls the die. All right, well, let's see if they would rout at all before we go too much further here. He would, so that's a 7. So I guess we give him cohesion of... That's one more than he would have, which would be 6. So I think he has a 6. If he would route, the owning player first rolls a die. Adding to that DR is the number of cohesion hits the unit incurred in excess of its TQ. and an additional plus 3 if the unit was the attacker in combat. Well, he wasn't the attacker, and he's not. He's at a plus 0. If the modified result is higher than the unit's TQ, he routs. Well, he isn't. Otherwise, it stands in place and is equal to its TQ minus 1, so a 5. Okay. So they basically just get an extra chance. Very good. So he's fine, although a bit rough. To be fair, he's finished, isn't he? No, he hasn't gotten yet. He's finished. Well, no, we need to try him again. 0, so he gets to go again. All right, what does that mean? Does that mean, because he can't order anyone to go because he's in combat. So what does that mean? He can give individual orders, but I don't think he can. After units finish issuing orders, eligible units in shock combat using the following sequence. Alright, now I'm confused. I'm gonna have to stop this one, I'll come back. Alright, I found what I wanted. Any leader other than the overall commander who starts an order phase in an enemy zone of control or enters an enemy of zone of control during an order phase may not issue orders. However, his command range may still be used to designate units to engage in shock combat in that segment of the orders phase, so he's not entirely useless. In addition, he may still use his charisma and personal combat ratings. He's not finished simply because he is in an enemy zone of control. However, he is finished and unable to activate if he comes under 515, or he has used his command range to allow units to engage in shock as above. If later in the game turn the leader is no longer in enemy zone of control, the player must activate him before any other leader. However, a leader so activated may not use momentum. So I think we're okay. So basically, he could tell them to attack again. Which I think we will in most places. Oh, I need to check on that, didn't I? About pushing forward. Because if we can, we would like to, I think. Maybe it's a little questionable. We might not have a choice. That would be the breakthrough. Attacking units required to advance, do so now. That's at 9.3. Advance after combat. Attacking units and any leader stacked with them must advance into any hex vacated by the enemy units as a result of shock. However, attacking units do not advance into hex vacated due to pre-shock TQ check. If they are also in the zone of control of another enemy unit. Alright, so he can't then. Advancing after combat does not require an order, but the advancing unit incurs all cohesion cost engendered by such a move. Okay, so he is in a zone of control of the enemy, so he cannot move forward. Okay. Alright, so who all do we want to attack with? Is it everyone? I'm a little concerned about this. But maybe I shouldn't be. We don't have to do TQ checks since we're already engaged. Well, we're definitely going to have him do it. The question is, do we have him wheel? I don't know if we can, even, because I think we can only issue shock commands. I don't think that we can issue a wheeling command. So he's going to shock. Well, he can shock both of those, can't he? Which means we could focus on just this guy and get 2-1. Yeah, let's, okay. So we're gonna shock this guy and this guy. Whereas he is going to shock these two gentlemen. And then here, I don't think I want to do these, actually. I think we're in a worse position. So let's try to break through these first and then maybe come around. Okay, so we don't have to roll TQ checks. So we're attacking him and him. I'll come back. All right, so here's the results of that. More routing, medium infantry, Illyrians. He's starting to move in. I don't think it's this guy routed from this guy, but he can't wheel to there. So I don't think he can move in that direction, basically. I think that's legal, yeah. Hard to say exactly. So, does he get another chance at momentum? Don't think so. I think he only gets one. Not sure we'd even want another one. To be honest. Although this guy's gonna get to go. And that's not gonna be good for us. Do we get to go again? Momentum. Well, he can't because the leader is in a zone of control or was previously in an enemy zone of control. Okay, so he couldn't have done that anyway. All right, I've already done it, but I'll remember that for the future. If they're in an enemy zone of control, they cannot do momentum. So that's another reason to not engage in the enemy, which seems a bit strange for the Alexander area of combat, because Alexander himself certainly led from the front. But if it takes away their possibility for momentum and then any hope of commanding most of the army, it seems like a poor choice. We'll see. Alright, now the question is, does Philip wants to try and trump this guy. So he's going to try. He doesn't. So what does that mean? 5.42. Okay, we tried to moment... Oh no. Trumping the trump. If and only if the active player is successful, the trump. We didn't try that. Active player trumpet. The player whose turn it would normally be this activation to activate his lowest leader rating may instead attempt to do someone higher. No, we can't do that. Okay, we can't trump the trump, can't momentum trump. So we couldn't have done that then. We would have to wait until he tried to go again, basically. Alright, so, but he's going to go for the first time here. He is engaged in combat. He has a command span of 7. Is that right? Yes. Well, command range of 7, and he can do a number equal to 6. So, the one's engaged in shock. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. He's going to do all of them. He will start here. No TQ check necessary. We'll go ahead and do this one on camera, I guess. We'll look at the table. That is a heavy infantry hoplite versus a phalanx, which is on the 6 table. A 6 on the 6 table is a 2-2. So that would mean 4 for us, which we'll have to do something about that. 7 for these guys. They'll have to do something about that as well. Again, on the same table, but... Wait. On the 7 table, but we get a plus 3. So 7. On the 7. Did I say 8 table before? It should be the 7 table. Heavy infantry versus phalanx. Wait. Heavy infantry versus phalanx. Frontal is on the 6 column. Okay. We rolled a 7 on the 6 column, which gets us a 2-2. Alright. So that brings him up to 4, which will be a check. And him up to 5, which will also be a check. He'll want to do everyone. So here to here. Next. On the 6 column, 7, is another 2-2. Actually, we could add him in here, couldn't we? No, let's not worry about it. 7-7. And then these two against him, a 5 and 5 is 10. He has a 10. So medium infantry versus phalanx is on the 5 table. But we've been rolling pretty well so far. A 3 is a 3-2, which is not great. So we have to take 2 on him. 1 on him, and 2 on him. Alright. Flipping my charts. Oh, casualty rating for him. A 0 is bad. 7 is fine. Alright, so that was the charge. Leader combat. That was the clash of spears. We must check for breakthrough. So this guy rolls. He gets a 2, so he's fine. This guy gets a 5 and is fine. So that goes back down to a 5. Him. A 3 stays at a 5. A 1 goes down to a 5. My fives. Did I roll for this guy? I don't think I did. A 1, he's fine. A 7, he's not fine. And he's not a phalanx, but he's a heavy infantry, so he gets another check. But he's at a plus 2, which is a 5 plus 2, so he's gonna be gone. Don't think that he gets eliminated immediately, but if he can't be rallied, basically this route phase, then he will get eliminated, and that's a bunch of points. And he'll have to move forward in some capacity. No, he's in an enemy zone of control, so he doesn't have to. Now we roll for this guy. He was in shock. A 7, he's gone as well. Route. He's fine. He's not fine. That's a 7. 0 is good. So he's back down to a 5. In an enemy zone of control. So I think that's that. So this guy's finished since he's in combat. Which leaves us with Philip. Philip is going to look on the rallying rules, try and get rid of some of these fives, so I'll be back as soon as I look at how that works. All right, so Philip can remove. You can't do it if someone is in a zone of control. So that limits us a couple. But we do have a few options here. He can get rid of two unless they're within range and line of sight of missile units, in which case he can get rid of one. So I think he's going to go over there and do that, leaving these guys. I mean, he might activate the companion cab before he moves. He has six, and he can do within 12. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. He has to move over one to get within range of him, which I think he'll want to, since he's got a number of those. So, let's see. I'm wondering if we should chase the routed units. Probably not. We'll just let them go. This guy's finished. He can't save them. So, let's move. We have a Hadassapist. We can do it separately, can't we? Alright, we have six that we can do. Well, we should probably get this companion cav unit to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 over to here and hit him. Flank. Yeah. And then this guy is a 5. We don't want to get him in, is the thing. So that was 1, 2... Alright, so that's 1, 2, 3. So we have 3 left. We're going to activate him. He's in the clear. Here are 2 of those. We're going to activate. Oh, he's not in the clear. He's in the clear, though. Here are 2 of those. So that was 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We still have 1 left. Can I activate him? I don't see why I couldn't. Wheel him around. One. Two. I think that's going to take some cohesion hits. For the wheeling, this guy doesn't matter, he's routing. Here we go. If half of a 2x unit is in enemy zone of control, that's fine. He's not in enemy zone of control. So I think that's perfectly legal. But he must EQ check because he's engaging in a new combat. And that guy's probably going to route before we'll have a chance to do much of anything. None of our guys are routing, so that's all of his activations. I think all that's legal, I hope. I hope. Let's do this one first, I guess. So let's roll for his shock. A 7 is fine. This guy, I'm afraid, might not be quite so fine. He rolled a 3, though, so he's okay for now. So that's that tactical quality shock. I need a way to remember that I've done the check, but I haven't done the shock yet. I guess I'll just flip it over. Alright. So let's roll the Hadassapist first. A 6 is fine. This guy, a 7 is not fine. So that would bring him up 3 for a 7. So he gets another check. A plus 3. A 0, he's fine, so that brings him back down to a 4. Lucky him. Flip this over. He's doing him. That's a 3, he's fine. That's a 7, he's not fine. Roll him again. A 1, he is fine, so he's back down to a 4. No checks needed. Okay, let's do this one. Heavy cav versus, what is this, medium infantry? Boop. Heavy cav versus medium infantry. Need other chart. Alright, heavy cav, medium infantry is a 7, although we're on the flank. It's only on the 8 table. It's a bit surprising. Alright. That's a 2. So a 2 on the 8 table is a 2-2. That and that. He's surprisingly okay. These guys are still engaged. Technically, I think. Okay, so Hadassapist. This guy wasn't ordered, so he can't attack. I was hoping to get him with a check, but. Alright, so a Hadassapist versus a Phalanx on the front. It's only a heavy infantry, so that's a 7 chart. However, he does have the numerical advantage, so we go to the left, which is a 6 chart. So on the 6 chart, roll the die, we get a 0, which is a 3 for us, 2 for him. However, that's going to put him at another check. And then this guy is attacking a flank. So a phalanx versus a heavy infantry on the flank is an 8. However, we have to minus 2 from our result because of him. That's not going to matter. So a 3-2. So that brings us to a 5. Do we have any 5s? A 5, which will result in a check for us. And a 2, a 6, which will also result... check for him. Once these battles get bigger, I'm going to have a really tough time remembering what's all checked and what hasn't. So he needs to check again for the breakthrough. A 7, he would break through, but he gets another shot. An 8, so he's gone. So 1 and 2 routed. He's going to be eliminated. He's in an enemy zone of control, but they're both in enemy zones of control. They can't go anywhere. He has to check. A 6, he would rout. And a 9, he would rout. No, he wasn't involved in shock combat. I'm silly. He wasn't involved. This guy was involved. And rolls a 6, which would rout. A 1 would not, so he goes down to a 4. Wait, it was a plus 1, wasn't it? Shoot, what did I roll? I rolled a 4, didn't I? 4 plus 1 is 5. He would rout, I think. Let me roll it again. A 7. Yeah, okay. So he would rout. I'm not sure what happens to the leader. But this battle is over. Routed. We'll see. That guy needs to check, though. He would rout. He saved. This guy would rout. Would not rout. Not rout with a 5. That's fine. And nothing happened over here. Okay, so everyone's activated. Philip is just going to finish himself. Because there's no one that he needs to try and rally, so he's fine. So let's look at the routing rules. We need to know point values as well. Where is that? Should be on one of these charts. If not, I'll have to mark it. Because that's important. There's the rally table. We might need that. Leader casualty check. I suppose, well, we already rolled that, didn't we? What else do we have here? Breakthrough gives 2 cohesion hits. If I were to move forward, I guess. That's troublesome. check the big board. No one has a chance to rally, so we're at the 10.22. They've already had their... the phalanxes have already had their checks. Alright, in the route movement segment of the route and reload phase, all routed 2 hex phalanx and heavy infantry units are eliminated. Eliminated. It's going to be a lot of points. Eliminated. I don't know what to do with him. Eliminated. Alright, that's that. All other routed units are moved their full MA in the same direction as 10.8, even if they moved during the previous game turns. They use all normal movement rules, except they may not enter enemy zones of controls. They do not incur cohesion hits. Alright, so he moves... 5, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's everyone. Unit that moves off map is eliminated. Running through other units, we don't have to worry about that. If a leader is stacked with a routing unit, that leader may route along with that unit. He is otherwise unaffected. Yeah, let's keep him. Oh, but what happens if it's eliminated? I assume he just stays there. Do not pay cohesion. They attempt to rally a routed unit. We'll see about that. All right, so let's see how many points these guys are worth. Where is that? Army withdrawal and victory. In general, a routes unit is worth its TQ with the following exceptions. Oxybellas are worth 0. Non-shock skirmishers are worth 1. One for the Macedonians. Shock skirmishers. Elephants and chariots are worth 2. 2 hex units are worth twice their TQ rating. Ouch. Eliminated leaders are worth 5 times their initiative. With the following exceptions. Alexander is worth much more. And Darius is also worth much more. Alright, so let's do this here. It's their tactical quality, so 5 times 2, so that's 10, 20, 30 for the Illyrians. And that's it, though. They still need 10 more in order to lose, so I guess they haven't lost yet, technically. Although, I imagine that they will. Now, this guy, I'm surprised he doesn't need to make another check, considering that his entire unit just disintegrated underneath of him. But that doesn't appear to be the case. We might be able to sneak in on him in some other fashion. But we only need 10 more points. We've eliminated all of their hoplites. So they've really got nothing left as far as that's concerned. For other points, everything else is only worth... these guys are worth 6, I suppose, so a couple more of those. Alright, so... what would happen next? Reload. So this guy gets to reload. This guy gets to reload, because they're not in combat. Think. Well, I should check, I suppose. 8.18. Any friendly missile low or missile no may remove during the reload of the route phase if it is not in enemy zone of control and if it is not within range of an enemy missile unit. Both of these are true. So that's fine. Don't need this. Don't need these. Everything else is fine. So that brings us back up to the lowest initiative. Which is, we need to flip all these guys over, and we need to flip all the moved guys over as well. I think that's everyone, right? Flip over here. So this guy would be first. He needs to go and try and rally some units, but he's within an enemy zone of control, so he can't. He can only be ordered by him. So we're going to try and do a trump for him in order to order him out and get some of these units unrouted, because he can do nothing in combat like this. We failed. So what does that mean? I think it's bad. I think it's bad. Trump. Active player trump. To do this, the player must roll the ladder's initiative or less. If successful, if unsuccessful, the original designated leader is activated, and the one who attempted the trump is finished. Wait. If unsuccessful, the originally designated leader is activated, and the one who attempted the trump is finished? What? Wait, that doesn't make sense. If successful, that leader is now activated. If unsuccessful, the originally designated leader is activated, and the one who attempted the trump is finished. Got it. So he's finished. He's activated. We're screwed. Right. The only thing he can do is have him attack him. That is the only thing we can do. So we do it. This is... We don't need to do the pre-check, so... That is on the roll of medium infantry against heavy infantry. So that's a 6. A 4 on the 6 column is a 2 and a 2. So that brings him up to 5. He's still fine. Him up to 2. He has to roll for a casualty. That's a 2. He's fine. So that was that. He's finished. So it's just up to us. And we're just going to absolutely destroy. So let's see what happens. If we can chase down leaders, or if they have an ability. I imagine they have ability to orderly withdrawal. But let's look that up. And I'm going to look it up, and I'll come right back. Well, that was an easy lookup. Yeah, basically, if anything moves adjacent to them, they can orderly withdraw. So, no worries about them being caught, other than by other cav. So the question is... Well, we activate Parmenio first here. So before he engages, he's going to... Let's see, who can he activate? Within a range of 8, 5 of them. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. He can do anyone. You know what, let's... Rally him. Not rally, I can't think of the exact term, but you know what I mean. Let's do this down the line. And then Philip can order them to go forward and crush. It's 1, 2, 3 units. He is adjacent, so he can't. We'll have him... Engage. Must TQ. That guy's probably gonna die. So that'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which is as many as we could do. Alright, so let's do a TQ check on the Illyrian first. That's a 6. He would fail. And starts to run away. 1, 2. We must move forward into his space, which is easy enough. (Clears throat) Okay. So that's that. No one else is attacking. I'm not even gonna try. Well, I might as well. There's no penalty to doing it. Yeah, he activates again. So try and chase them down, I guess. Bring him down to a three. Move him. Two. Shock must EQ. To move the difference, which is 5 to 7, so 1, 2, 2. I think we can, do this without much trouble. And yeah, I think that's fine. So he's routed, probably gonna die. Actually, he's not even worried about it. He doesn't have his own control. Basically, I want to chase these guys off the map. This is Philip, right? So he'll activate these guys as well. That should be fine. 1, 2, 3, 4. I don't think it's gonna matter at this point, is the thing. So. All right, let's try this one first. He has to make a shock DQ check. He's fine. He's not fine. That brings him up to a 7. No, wait, he is fine. My mistake. Him. He's fine. So everyone's fine there. I don't know what happens here. We'll just take care of this first. See if the leader dies. He doesn't. A 1. So we have a phalanx versus a heavy infantry from a flank. It's on the 11 table, but a leader gives us a minus. He's finished. -2 on the die roll. So a 4 on the 11 table. So this guy's down 3. We're down 2. So he's at a 5, which means he has to check, see if he runs, and we get 1 each. We're both fine. Check him. 8, he's gonna get the heck out of there, along with the leader. Routed. And I think we can call this one. This guy would have to move into his space. And so on and so forth. But I think we can safely call that one because these guys, at least some of them, are going to go off. The map this time, there's no other leaders to activate if we were to finish Philip because these guys move 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Even if the leader stayed, that's still, I think these are 2 each. No, it's their number of attack quality points. So that's like 6, 16, 17, 9, 20, 20, 20, 22. So that's like a 52. This guy goes, that's another 5 points. This guy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 just stays on. But yeah, that puts the Illyrian route points up to 57. They only needed a 40, so they got absolutely smashed by Philip, which is to be somewhat expected. Oh, shoot, I didn't give the Illyrians subtract 2, Subtract 2 from all Lyran pre-shock TQ checks unless they're being attacked by a Hadassapist or Companion Cavalry. Shoot. I just forgot that. I'm just learning the system here. There's a lot of stuff to it, in case you can't tell. So, clear that I'm going to make some mistakes. That was Erigon Valley. The next one is Crocus Fields, C-R-O-C-U-S, which is another Philip II battle versus the Phocians, I think. It looks like a little bit of a bigger battle. That one says 3 or 4 hours. I'm not sure how long this one took. A couple of hours at most is what it should have taken, but very interesting. More complicated than Men of Iron for sure. There's a lot more. There's not so much more fiddliness. The cohesion markers are a little more fiddly, but you still have to mark units that are engaging in shock in that, just like in this. The fact that you have to check the tactical quality of things is interesting. It is better, I think, because, you know, units, non-disciplined units, will not engage, especially these heavier, like, phalanxes. So it shows that they might run away before they even get engaged, which is certainly a possibility. This was a smaller scale one, and hopefully I didn't do too bad with the rules. Let me know if I made any major errors, but I will keep going with this. I like it. I certainly like Men of Iron. This just seems like a couple steps up. And Alexander is one of my favorite topics of study. So these battles, especially once we get to sort of the more famous ones, will be very interesting. So thank you for joining me. That's it for the first battle in the Deluxe 5th edition of the Great Battles of Alexander the Macedonian Army. And I'll see you guys next time.